Hi, I'm Al Levine, the Talking Machine. Welcome to another edition of The Creative Process with Vince Ornato. Today he's going to introduce you to the concept of composition in art. The Creative Process with Vince Ornato. Vince is a professional Pittsburgh artist that works in many mediums. And now Vince is going to share his creative process with you.
Hi everybody, I'm Vince Ornato and we're going to talk about composition in art today and concept. It's not discussed enough among amateurs and in a lot of classrooms. And composition in a painting or a drawing is not what things are, but where they go. And the idea is how to compose a painting, how to compose a drawing. You should always be thinking in terms of composition every time you do any type of rendering at all, even if something that just has one subject in it, where it goes on the surface and the shape and size of the surface. And that's what we're going to talk about today. Okay, what we're going to do today in part is discuss composition in everything. This is a portrait I did years ago. This is an artist friend of mine from New Hampshire sitting on a kind of an antique bench, a padded bench. Before I ever started this was her pose. A bunch of other artists were working together, and this is Dee Johnson. This is her pose, and I had to decide how I wanted to do my own rendering. And the way to do that is to check from certain angles, different things I might want to do, and so on and so on. It's not arbitrary. Nothing in this is arbitrary. But what's interesting about it, you can over-plan. You can over-design. You need to save energy for the actual piece itself. This is a painting in pastel. If it's done in color, it's a painting, even though it's a dry medium. If it's in black and white, it's a drawing. You can do drawings with oil paint, black and white oil paint. So notice how angular she is. Her arm, her right arm is up on her lap. The way her legs are crossed, the position of her in the composition. Notice the red in the background on the bench. These are all elements that I was very aware of when I decided to go with this pose here. Keep in mind, if you think of this as a camera lens, I could have slid the lens away from the red background, which is the bench she's sitting on, and centered her more directly right in the middle of the paper. Or I could have got tight and just did maybe a head and shoulders and did it that way. There's 1,001 different ways to do this, and all of them would be good. But the artist, at the point of contact, the point of the beginning, you have to decide which way you're going to go. And that's difficult a lot of times for people. They're not sure what to do. You have to make a decision, and you have to make a bold one and say, I'm going to go with this. And there's a lot of history in my mind with design and different elements that made me think I'd like to do it this way. And I was pretty happy with how it turned out. So that's the issue with this portrait. What we're going to do now, we're going to look at a couple different pieces of artwork I did over the years as a way to get across the point of composition to you. The first couple shows we talked about when I worked at National Record Mart, which was a retail store, and I did a lot of signs and concept things for them. I'm using this because it's a little unusual. It's very bright. I want people to see it in the store. I wanted it to pop. The composition, there's a lot of negative space in it. I kind of had a fight with my boss a little bit to get this across, and it worked really well. The idea was to grab people's attention. And whichever record album had a sticker on it, those are the ones that are on sale. And it was the whole idea, much like the piece I showed in the earlier episodes. And composition is critical with this idea. If you just put this stuff any place on it, it's not going to work. Negative space in a painting or drawing is understood to be the area in the composition without subject. For example, if you did a cityscape, well, the buildings, the bridges, and so on would be the subject. The negative space, in effect, is the sky. I want to use this painting I did of the Clareton Works to point out something about negative space. A lot of times, people think of negative space only as just background, so on and so on, but really, it's a shape with hardly anything in it, so to speak. This area here, this river, is critical to this painting, believe it or not, in my mind, the way I wanted to do the painting of the mill. I wanted to include the river, but compositionally and artistically, it's an element that most people don't even think about when they see it because the rest of this is so interesting and complex. If I would have did a composition whereas this would have all been the steel mill also, there would have been a problem because it would be almost too cluttered. There's so much complexity in this painting that the eye almost needs a place to rest. And by comparison, this makes this more dramatic and not less dramatic and not end up looking just like wallpaper. It's really because of this shape here of the river that most people don't really think much about when they see the painting, but I'm telling you, as the creator of it, it's critical to get across what I was trying to do visually. This is a sketchbook piece that I did in New Orleans in Preservation Hall years ago. I was actually sitting on the floor drawing. Again, if a person saw each of these pieces, you know, the advertising piece at National Record Mart and this drawing, they might think two different artists did it. But all the elements of composition, idea, and design come into play. And this was a on-site, live, improvisational-type drawing that I did while sitting on the floor. But these elements that I'm talking about, I thought of while I did it. This is a painting, snow painting, that I did from my deck outside my studio, which you saw in the first episode. And wintertime, it was cold. I paint on site a lot. I used to do that more than I do now, but I drew on site a lot, and when I crossed over to painting, I started painting on site. Now, the point I'm making here is, again, composition and design really come into play. And a lot of the advertising background I had really helped with these types of dramatic composition. In the beginning, I liked to kind of push sort of an abstract look into a realistic type of painting, and that's what it's going on here. I want to make another comment about abstraction in art. Notice this is the rooftop of a church, St. Elizabeth's in the Strip District. I'm going to turn it upside down. So you now see shapes and color and form more than subject. As you look at it, you know it's the rooftop and your brain will start processing it. But again, these are abstract shapes that end up making a realistic painting. But again, all paintings are abstract because this really isn't a church. It's a bunch of paint on a canvas. This is a painting of St. Elizabeth's Church in the Strip District that I did years ago. Again, I painted on site. People would comment about the kind of Edward Hopper look that I was starting to achieve. It wasn't anything intentional, although he's one of my favorite artists, but seeing the, as Henry Kerner would call it, the cubistic elements around Pittsburgh, the shapes, the textures, the color, so on and so on, really intrigued me. And those were the very same principles that I used if I was designing an ad for a commercial art purpose. Because composition and design is composition and design. One of the dilemmas going on today that I see all over the place is a lot of the websites are overly cluttered in the eye. There's no first point of interest, second point of interest. They're kind of too busy. They're not kind of too busy. They are too busy, and they're confusing. So that's not what you want. This is another example then of some of the compositional elements that I'm discussing. I want to mention something again about cubism, and this also relates to perspective. Notice how my head, my face, is in much crisper focus than the elements behind me, which are actually some of my Italy paintings in my studio. My face is brighter, more vibrant colors, and sharper edges as compared to what is behind me. When you paint and draw, this should be something of what you're doing or what you're playing with. These are some of the elements that are very important to make a painting look like a painting. Remember, drawing and painting was invented a couple thousand years before photography, because the modern person spends many, many hours looking at film, television, and now with smartphones and so on. There's a misunderstanding that the eye sees everything in crisp focus. It doesn't. Now, if you were to look behind me and focus on one of those paintings, my face would start becoming a little blurry, as we're showing here. The painting up over my left shoulder and then your left side of the frame is in crisper focus, and look what happens to my face. That's what I'm talking about, and our director did a great job here to show how this works in nature and the way the human eye really does see things. This is a piece called Leaving Sicily that I did a few years ago. I was in Sicily and did several pieces there. Some of the elements, compositional elements, are, it's 3x1. It's 3 foot wide and 1 foot deep. It's not quite what we call pinched perspective. That's when you have the subject and pinch it real tight to one of the sides or the top or the bottom. However, what we might call the background, which is the sky, is maybe, I'd call it, two-thirds at least of the image, and you pinch down the subject this way. That's more dramatic, and it's seen a lot. And again, a person doesn't think about this. They're just affected by the artwork or the movie or photograph, whatever. But the person creating it should be thinking about these types of things to get across what they're trying to say. This is a visual language. You have to decide what you want to say, what you want to do, much like the way I was, you know, painting the portrait. How do I want to do it? And so on and so on. This is, again, this is 3 foot by 1 foot deep. And I have another that goes in the other direction from Sicily. This is another piece from Sicily. If anybody's been there, they know it's Sicily is technically about 85% mountainous. And I just wanted to do some of the houses on the hillside. And again, this is 3x1. It's the same measurement as the other painting I showed, which was going across the Strait of Messina called Leaving Sicily. But obviously, this is a vertical composition. The other one was horizontal. And there's a reason why I chose this. It has to do more with the subject in this case because of the way Sicily is. You have to sort of be there to understand. It's tall and wide at the same time. So this type of, I'll call it a dramatic format, the 3x1, really lends itself to the subject itself. Inside of it, there's all kind of issues, the typically warm and cool colors, texture. There's a lot of stone in Sicily, trying to get that across. What's very important to understand about painting is every single painting is actually an abstract, because even though it's a realistic subject, this really isn't a bunch of houses in Sicily. It's paint on a surface. It's all an illusion. When you see Rembrandt's portraits, it is a man sitting in a chair, but it's not. It looks like that. It's an illusion. It's paint on a pigment on a surface. So all these things come together in everything the artist does. The sketchbook piece I showed you of New Orleans, it looks like musicians, but it's really ink on a pulp. And you're giving the illusion of reality, even in a realistic painting. Very similar to a play. They aren't real people. They're actors playing characters. Those characters aren't real.
And so on and so on. There's a famous play, Pirandello's Six Characters in Search of an Author, where they argue that in the play, are the characters real or not? But for our purposes, it's important to understand that warm and cool colors, your composition, so on and so on, are the tools or the language the person's using to express what they see in their mind's eye. And the idea doesn't have to be phenomenal. Again, Rembrandt's portraits is just a man sitting in a chair. What's more ordinary than that? But look what he did with it. It's the form that the idea takes that the art comes from. And that's the important thing to understand. I always use the example of Shakespeare, Romeo and Juliet. Boy meets girl, their parents don't approve. That's the story. But it's the form that the story takes that gives it art and gives it life. Songs are very similar. The idea doesn't have to be phenomenal, but the way the idea is executed is where the art comes from, and that's what makes it special. I want to talk a little bit about framing in art. And what I don't mean like a picture frame, I mean your compositional shape. As you saw with some of the paintings, one was 3 foot wide and only 1 foot tall. Other ones, like the portrait of my artist friend D, that was 18 by 24. All framing is the shape that you've decided you want to use to put your composition in. I'm showing this piece purposely because it's very complex. This is called A Courageous Tale. People in Pittsburgh may remember 1978, an iron worker had his leg amputated 250 feet in the air when the Brady Street Bridge that they were demolishing collapsed and pinned his legs. He was able to get one out, but they had to do an amputation. It's a very famous incident. It's written up in paramedic books and so on. And I was actually an iron worker at the time that happened in 78. So the subject's near and dear to my heart, and it's an amazing situation. The iron worker's name is Ralph Winter. You can Google it, construction accident and so on. I have prints of this that I've sold in different parts of the world, actually. But back to the art part of it, composition. Notice, to make this dramatic, it was raining when this happened. Nobody was tied off. It was a very dangerous situation. Miraculously, nobody got hurt except Ralph. The bottom third of this painting, when you first glanced at it, I'm sure you did not notice that about 30% of this painting is basically this girder, this cool blue color down here. This is all blue back around here, which is also a cool color. I'm very aware of this. There was a lot of thinking that went into this. I had to do sketches and so on. There wasn't much reference material. I went out and met Ralph. He was 78, 79 years old when I did this. These warm colors in the face, in the safety vest, the hard hats, they make these issues pop forward against the cool colored background, if you understand what I'm saying. The idea, and I'm very conscious of this when I executed it, I purposely chose those colors. That's a lot what they mean when they say artistic license. Artistic license does not mean I'm an artist, I can do what I want, I have artistic license. You learn what a lot of the basic rules, quote unquote, are in order to break them. This scene, these colors and all, are superimposed by me. There wasn't much reference material. There was some newspaper photos, this type of thing here. There's some old grainy film that I had to look at. So much of this is out of my imagination, but it works. It looks like, you know, what it's about. And I did it as if it was an illustration in a book as a way to get viewers to understand, you know, what this is. And this is sort of, you know, I nicknamed it like the book's called A Courageous Tale, Chapter 5. And then this would have been some of the text explaining, you know, what I'm telling you. And I kind of got the idea from being at the Wyeth Museum in Brandywine. Andrew Wyeth and his father was a great illustrator. And there had a lot of his original paintings, Last of the Mohicans and so on, like that. And this type of look was sort of in the back of my mind. I got it from looking at N.C. Wyeth's paintings. And the reason I want to show you it because it's so complex, back to my drawing from New Orleans. Some people would look at the two of these and not even be sure the same artist did them. But again, idea, composition, even color, because black is a color and white is a color. On this drawing, it's dramatic because you have a very dark color going against a very light color. And the viewer will fill in their mind, if it's done well, what it is. And the reason I bring this back out, notice the triangle of these musicians on the top, if you can see that. Notice the triangle here. What I mean by triangle is the bottom is wider than the top in any way. That gives strength to most compositions. You can invert that. You might want to do a painting of a storm and the triangle is upside down. That creates tension because the bottom would be smaller than the top. And because of gravity, that's unusual for us. There's a little extra tension. Now, again, the person, when they look at these things, they're not using these words in their head. They're just being affected by it. It's sort of like when you watch a play, a movie, listen to a song. You're affected by it. And hopefully, the connection is made between the artist and the viewer. In other words, the concept in my mind, what I'm trying to get across with this painting, people get, connect to it. When paramedics, firemen, people like that see this piece, they just go nuts. I mean, they really, really dig this piece because they connect to it. Other people that remember this see it and they oh yeah, it brings back a memory that they knew everything worked, that the guy lived. And then other people that know nothing about it, they have an entirely different reaction. It needs explained a little bit, and then they read the copy here. So those are three different types of persons that see it and three different types of reaction. But I'm pretty pleased with it. I think I got across what I was trying to do with it. I want to make another comment about framing. As you see in this painting of Ralph Winter, there's a lot going on. Now, I can take certain sections of it, for example, and get tighter and tighter and tighter. Notice how it's getting more dramatic as I crop out certain parts of it. This is a little tricky for me to do here, but I think you get the idea. Notice how each of these compositions are different and they convey, maybe you want to emphasize the fireman that was up helping him. You want to emphasize the intensity of his expression. Every one of these compositions say a slightly different thing and is related to the overall idea of this painting. And all I've done was reframe. All I've done was reframe. And when I decided to do what you see in the completed painting, I had to make that artistic decision. What I want to do here is use a portrait type sitting to demonstrate the effect light has on whatever subject it is your painting, whether it be a building, landscape, portrait, still life, and so on. And I want to use Alan Levine here to demonstrate what I mean by that. And lighting is part of composition and design. It's a critical part. In fact, a painter friend of mine up in New England always says every subject is the same, light. Edward Hopper was a master of light. There's every time you paint something, light is involved, and that light is part of the composition. I want to make another comment about the portrait I did here of this artist friend of mine years ago. Obviously, this is the finish. All right. Now, here is a current portrait that I'm working on for a client. Big difference, okay? This is the planning and the layout part of the portrait. In the end, it's going to look of the quality that you just saw. So this, or this here is some of the thumbnail sketches that I started doing for the composition. And the reason I'm showing this is to demonstrate to you that when you do a portrait, if you know what you're doing, you don't just sit someone down and start drawing. Even if you do, sketch artists work that way. I certainly work that way when I'm doing caricatures. I'm doing the composition in my head before I even start the caricature or portrait. And I used to do charcoal portraits that way, 15-minute quick studies. So just to reiterate that this stuff is not arbitrary. It's done in a thoughtful way, and composition and design is critical to making it look good. One of the main points I really need to get across, and it's a critical point, composition and design is very much decision making. You have to decide which way you want to go. This is the only way you can have your say. You're better off making a blunder and going down in flames than making a wishy-washy decision. And if you're good, you're going to find out you're going to have to leave out some good stuff. Hemingway has a great line for writers. If you're good, you're going to have to learn how to kill your darlings. And what he means by that, it's easy to not use the stuff that isn't very good. Maybe you were tired or whatever. But you have a certain concept in your mind, a certain idea that you're trying to get across to people. Along the way, you may come up with something pretty nifty alongside of that, whether in your painting or your song that you're writing or whatever, but it may not go with your original concept, and you're going to have to learn how to eliminate stuff, and that's what Hemingway meant by killing your darlings. That's not always easy, but it has to be done along this decision-making process. Again, don't be afraid to fail. Make bold decisions. You can only do one drawing or one painting at a time at the exclusion of all the other ones you could be doing, and go for it and really learn how to express yourself this way. I like to give a book recommendation with each show. This is Painting as a Pastime by Winston Churchill, surprisingly. A lot of people don't know Winston Churchill was an amateur painter. He didn't start painting until he was 41 years old. And this is really an essay. It's only about 33 pages long. What's fantastic about it is the first 8 or 10 pages is really more about what he believes the importance of having a hobby that you're passionate about and learn with it and grow with it. He discovered painting when he was 41 and became a pretty good amateur painter. The book is out of print now, but because of the miracle of the internet, it's very easily found. Winston Churchill's Painting as a Pastime. It's only going to cost you a few bucks. AbeBooks.com is who I buy a lot of used books and out of print books through. AbeBooks.com, A-B-E. Winston Churchill's Painting as a Pastime is an excellent book for anybody, even non-artists.
Thank you for watching today's show. Hope you enjoyed it. Tune in next time when Vince Ornato talks about the issue of concept and idea in art.